welcome everybody. A brief introduction about Vulcan. Vulcan Steel commenced in 1995 in New Zealand as basically a building materials distributor and value-add processor. So we very much see ourselves as an industrial product distributor and value-add processor. Back in 2002, we expanded into Victoria from New Zealand, further expanded into Queensland in 2007, and then expanded our product range to include stainless and engineering steels in 2014 and 2018. The company continued to grow from a very small startup of half a dozen people to over 800 employees, and we listed late last year, so we're in the first year of being a listed entity. A brief recap of Vulcan's business model. We're in two key divisions, steel and metals. Steel includes steel distribution, plate processing, and coil processing. Metals include stainless steel and engineering steels. Our split is 2-1, so a majority of our volume and sales is in Australia. And in our terms of our market segments, we're widely distributed across most segments within the economy, from engineering, building construction, manufacturing, roll forming, food-based products for stainless steel like wine and dairy, and mining for engineering steels. The quick summary here in terms of client numbers, we've got over 7,000 clients buy off us each month, and the top 20 clients represent just 13% of our total sales. With regard to our footprint, as I indicated, the company originally started business in New Zealand, so we've got a number of sites right throughout New Zealand, but in Australia, we've got a number of sites as well, but we're not fully networked right across Australia, and we're still continuing to do that, which gives us a further growth opportunity. We've got over 800 employees, about 830, of which there's about 100 truck drivers. We run our own trucking fleet. We have 12,000 clients that buy off us in a quarterly or yearly program, but on average, 7,000 per month purchase off the company. Now, a recap on how and why Vulcan's successful. The key element here is we've got our own in-house IT system based on a Microsoft platform, but we have our own programmers. So we've designed a unique proprietary IT system that provides real-time information to make our business highly efficient and responsive to client needs. It also enables our employees to respond quickly with the right information and data. Within our organization structure, we have a very, very flat structure. So we run a non-hierarchical, what we call a single status culture, where all employees are encouraged and empowered to make their own decisions. This means we have very low overheads. It also means we're extremely responsive. Our philosophy is simple. We expect all people to make their own decisions. As a matter of course, when you think about it, an adult shouldn't look over another adult's shoulder and tell them what to do. So this applies right throughout our organization. So clients, when they talk to a truck driver, a store person, salesperson, they can get a decision and a person that engages with them. This is relatively rare, we believe, across our industry and across industrial products. What this flat structure and culture, coupled with this very responsive and flexible IT system, enables us to really double down on our key competencies. And they include very detailed focus on inventory management. So what we're trying to achieve here is best-in-class inventory availability. Given we've got 7,000 clients buying off us each month, and they have a wide variety of items they buy, and they vary by our 29 locations in the different market segments right across Australasia, very precise inventory management is critical. As you can probably appreciate, if you have a breakdown or some other urgent requirement of steel, it's no good only having 2 out of 3 items. You need all 3. Also, processing capability. We're heavily focused on cutting or processing material to what people want. This involves cutting engineering steels, processing coil and sheet, or plate processing, where press brakes bend or shape the steel to the required requirement for the client. As I referenced before, we've got a very low overhead structure due to our flat organization structure and empowered workforce. Also, our IT drives huge efficiencies. So what this means is we have a very much a paperless-based focus and an ongoing emphasis on managing costs and overheads, not just for the sake of managing costs and overheads, but the sake of being efficient and flexible and the ability to respond rapidly to market changes. Lastly, customer service. huge focus on customer service, and a focus on all 29 units knowing their local customers extremely well. This also involves very high DIFOT. We strive to achieve 100% DIFOT every week right across our network. Typically, we run 98 to 99 DIFOT depending on what unit and what's available at that particular time, but we have leading class DIFOT across the organisation. In terms of our growth, as you can see, even though we're in a traditional segment as an industrial company, we're very much focused on growth. So the company has grown from a very small startup to fast approaching a $1 billion business. There's five key components of our growth. First, brownfields expansion. So in all our 29 sites and across our five divisions, each area is trying to grow more market share and serve more clients in their given area. Again, that is unusual in the sense that we do a lot of cold calling and we incentivize our sales force to gain new business. Separately, our second point of growth is new geographies. As I pointed out before, Australia has got a lot of areas where we haven't fully exploited our capability. So for example, we'll expand our five divisions across more centers across Australia. As an example, Western Australia, we just have engineering and stainless. So we've got three divisions to open up there. We have the secondary cities right across Australia. And we've got other segments that we can open and offer in the future. Also, we're looking at expanding our product range. So as we've said before, 2014, 2015, we entered stainless. And then a few years later, we entered engineering steels. We've now grown a significant division called metals in that relatively short period. We are looking at new opportunities with new, completely new product ranges, which match our current competencies and give us even greater synergy and operating leverage. We're also looking at opportunistic M&A. So where we can't do a greenfield startup, or where an opportunity crops up where we can buy, say, for example, a plate processing business in a geographic area we are not present, we'll acquire that business if it's at the right price. So that's a great opportunity. And lastly, in our prospectus, we outlined a number of business improvement initiatives which focused around growth. We really looked at that period and we said, look, we believe we can achieve an annual run rate improvement based on that numbers back last year of $60 million New Zealand over 36-month period. We're well on track on that, and we'll achieve that through our program of focusing on working out which geographic area we've got a real advantage in. Now I'd like to turn to the financials to give you a sense of the success of the business. Our first half year as a listed company, we turned over $463 million. We had an EBITDA of 118 and adjusted net profit after tax of 70 million. We were very proud to advise that one in five of our employees proactively purchased shares in the company. And we also generated a cash flow of 36 million and paid our shareholders just in the last few days a dividend of 27 and a half cents. Our operating backdrop in the first half was challenging, as you know, and no doubt aware. Both Australia and New Zealand experienced a lot of problems associated with COVID. We had multiple shuts and problems right across the industry in New Zealand and Australia. Despite that, we continue to serve our clients well and manage that to a good standard. We also saw the world steel price decline at the tail end of last year. And we also saw the freight rates, we thought they had peaked back in that last period. Obviously, the interest rates began to rise and we saw a weaker Australian and New Zealand dollar in that period. Of course, since this period and outlook, we've experienced the changes of the Ukrainian war. So the circumstances have changed somewhat since then. From a group financial performance viewpoint, here you can see our financial data, and the return on capital employed is 35%, which is an outlier within the industry. And as I repeat, a $70 million after-tax profit. If you look at our EBITDA change, we grew by 17 million. We improved margins by 53 million. And what you see there is an ongoing program of improvement. It is important to highlight, however, that the 16.7 million volume did come off a prior period where there had been some shuts in relation to COVID-19. The key point around this COVID disruption is that we believe we've seen most of that pass by, and we're now in a period where it is starting to settle down. And a lot of our products and customers, their work has been delayed rather than cancelled. Now I'd like to turn to our balance sheet and dividend. Vulcan is a very well managed company from a balance sheet perspective. We have a very low debt leverage ratio of 0.68 at the end of December, and we focus on ensuring that our debt level is always at a prudent level. We've got uncommitted funds available, and we have a payout ratio of 60 to 80%. So we're committed to paying out after-tax profits of 60 to 80%, as demonstrated by our first dividend of 27.5 cents in the interim period. Our outlook and guidance for the next year, the key elements about this guidance is we've upgraded it from our initial prospectus, and now we're guiding for between 107 and 114 million after tax. When we announced the company's listing, our prospectus advised it was 74 million. So we've raised our guidance to 107 to 114 million. I think this demonstrates that as a company, we're conservative in our views. We focus on growth and achievement. And we've gone through the very challenging period of COVID successfully. And we see a very strong outlook for most of our products. And we have a very strong view that the outlook, particularly for growth, is high, with a number of acquisition opportunities likely to emerge, as well as our greenfields focus. Now I'm open to any questions.